So next point is about the protest, right? Additional information can be submitted through protest procedure. The protest procedure is heavily discussed in 19 CFR Part 1, Summative 4. Remember that. Additional information can be submitted through protest procedure for liquidated entries. Yes, it can. Let's take a look at this, at the relevant question from the previous customs, licensed customs broker exam. All right. A drawback claim was filed on June 2006. A review of drawback claim revealed untimely exports. So untimely exports meaning that you have certain time period to export. So it can be either 3 years or 5 years, right? But untimely export was done. So you did not export the product within the time frame which you were provided for. On January 15, 2007, the drawback claim was liquidated for no drawback, of course, because the export was untimely. It was not within the statute of limitations from the time of import, right? Or under the five-year rule, from the within that 5 year from the date of importation of the merchandise. So that's no go, and that killed all the efforts to get the money back. So that's pretty much on point. The drawback claimant must to challenge the liquidation of the drawback. So amend the drawback claim. Well, since it's liquidated, this is no go, right? Only the protest procedure is available. Perfection. Perfection is only when customs comes back to you and asks you additional information. But customs decided not to go for additional information. They just liquidated without any refund. So no, that is not a situation of perfection. File a timely protest. Yes, you have 180 days from the date of liquidation to file a protest. Provide a notice of intent to export, destroy, or return the merchandise for the purposes of drawback. Well, here is the thing. You can apply for waiver, but you have to apply for waiver before the fact. You can apply for one time waiver before the fact, but that's very discretionary. So that discretion was not utilized. Customs could have done by under the claim perfection rubric, but that was not done. So D is not applicable. E, provide a written request for payment of drawback based on estimated duties. Well, that request was part of the drawback filing 7551, right? So this is too late for that because it's already liquidated. So the written request was already done. It makes no sense to pick this answer because it is not responsive to the question asked. So the correct answer, the drawback claimant must file a timely protest to challenge the liquidation if they can challenge it, because they have to have a reason. Here it seems like untimely exports were not a valid reason unless it was untimely exports were commingled with timely exports and customs rejected for timely and untimely. So what you would do in a protest is you request customs to do a partition, because some of them were validly claimed, some of them were not. All right, so C here is the correct answer choice. All right, so now we'll go to rejection, which is self-explanatory, because rejection means customs says no. Rejection usually takes place when there is a sloppy paperwork where essential elements are missing. So claim, if it's incomplete, if essential information is missing, the claim will be rejected and you will get a notice. So what happens then, right? Well, here's the punchline. If you still within that 3 year window, 3 years from the date of exportation or destruction, then you can resubmit the claim. If you're outside that 3-year window, it depends when customs will notify this. You're out of luck. The point here in this particular thing, right, is that 191.51e time of filing requirement. It's not within 3 years from the date you received the notice. It's within 3 years. Make a note of that. It's within 3 years from the date of exportation or destruction. And again, I am going to stress this again and again. The statute of limitations here is dispositive, and it's under 151, section 191.51e. Time of filing must be filed within 3 years after the date of exportation and destruction. So if customs rejects it, you can still file again, as long as you meet that 3-year requirement after the date of exportation and destruction. Not after you get the notice, but after you get the after the date of exportation and destruction. Very important stuff. Alright, so of course Trade Enforcement Act changed it to 5 years from the date of importation. So you have this old rule and new rule dichotomy now. Alright. Question on point. Upon review of drawback claim, if the claim is determined to be incomplete, the claim will be rejected and customs will notify the filer in writing. So far, it's a restatement of law. The filer shall then have the opportunity to complete the claim subject to the requirement for filing a complete claim within blank, and here the hint is statute of limitations. So you have 3 year statute of limitations, which is in 191.51e, section 191.51e, 3 years, right on point. For this reason is correct, all the other questions are incorrect. So this one you just have to know, right? 3 years from the date of exportation or destruction. All right, so now we get to the restructuring. Under 191.53. So restructuring deals with administrative efficiency. So you may file your claim in a cumbersome way, at least from the customs point of view, and customs becomes annoyed. So they say, okay, you need to restructure the way you make your claims. So for example, on form CBP form 7551, the drawback entry, right? You may be filing only one line item per drawback entry, and you may do that because for whatever reasons you have, it's easier for you to keep the data keeping. It's easier for you to do this accounting thing. All right, no problem. But customs says, hey, listen. Why don't you just consolidate all your stuff instead of me writing it out, giving you the separate drawback entry number for all your import entries, for per one import entry. I just want to give one drawback number for many entries. And to me, it's more efficient, so I don't have to keep track, enter this into the database if it's a manual entry. I do not have to. I can save myself time if you will help me on this one. Just write down several entries, not just one entry per drawback. I'm talking about the import entry. So we're talking about the concept of administrative efficiency. So customs says restructure your claim in favorable way so that I can more administratively do, more efficiently do my job. So this is claim restructuring. So the because we live in a world of rules and regulations, of course customs cannot decide this for whatever reasons. There is a set of reasons why customs may want to do that, and there is a set of reasons the drawback claimant can respond in by saying no. And this is the point of claim restructuring, is what are the what is the guiding criteria? So as I mentioned before, the guiding criteria is mentioned in 191 section 53, restructuring of claims. And the factors for the CBP decision include the number of transactions, value of claims, frequency of claims, type of product being claims, and drawback ruling. But customs may not require a claimant to restructure if one of those following things apply. And this would be the reason for you to come to customs and say, no, customs, I qualify for an exemption from claim restructuring because I either have multiple commodities, meaning so I import food and computers at the same time, and both of them are subject to drawback, but I'd rather to deal with food products under the separate drawback claim as opposed to the computer products because they are subject to different manufacturing processes, they are subject to different accounting processes, and they are subject to different warehousing processes, for example. So because even though those two commodities are brought under one umbrella, I still want to use two different drawback claims to differentiate. So that would be one example. Drawback ruling. So you file a ruling with customs, and customs says, this is how, this is the treatment you must afford to this particular type of commodity. Multiple manufacturing locations. So we're talking about the geography factor. Difficulty in adjusting accounting and inventory methods. So it kind of goes back to the example with multiple commodities where you have different set of systems and you want to keep one set of system homogeneous to one set of product while another system to a different set of products. Significantly different method of operation, variable conflicting manufacturing and inventory periods. So the bottom here is restructuring. The bottom line is the restructuring should not be allowed if it makes it very burdensome for the drawback claimant to follow the customs efficiency. So what's easier for customs if it substantially makes the drawback claimant's life more difficult, then can be broadly construed. They're pretty broad statements. If you can qualify, then you can respond to customs with proposition to say to withdraw the request to restructure. All right. So let's take a look at how this is being tested. As you notice, once you have a laundry list of items, right? Once you have the laundry list of items, whether on the exception side or whether on the factor side, you still customs is likely to test you by asking you which one is not, and they give you all the ones that are, and you have to pick out the one that doesn't fit one of those line item criteria. So question goes like this: which one of the following criteria is used in demonstration of a claimer is not used in demonstration of claimant order to exempt from restructuring of drawback? So customs comes back with restructuring. The claimant must think of some exception criteria. So we look at the exception list and we just mix and match, right? So the first answer deals with complexities caused by multiple manufacturing. So we have multiple manufacturing commodities. Oh, we have locations. Okay, I'm sorry. So locations are here. So this fits the one of the correct criteria. So B, E, we're looking for the one that's not. B is the reason. So we move on. Complexity is caused by significantly different methods of operation. Significantly different methods of operation is on the list. So B is good. C, complexity is caused by misinterpretation of various regulations. So if you cannot read various regulations, that's really your problem, because regulations, even though they're complex, they may be complex, right? This may not be the reason, because regulations are there to regulate you, if it's too difficult for you, hire an expert, all right? It's not on the operational side, it's on the interpretative side. This is something which you're expected to know, you're expected to read. As you're preparing for the exam, when you sit on the exam, you're expected to know all those complexities. If not, you will not pass. So this is not on the list. The regulations are not on the list, even though derivatively you may have some kind of in records which are subject to regulations, right? But it's not the interpretation, it's the adjustment, okay? It's the compliance adjustment cost. It's not the interpretative methodology cost. So C is not on the list. Since we're looking for the one that's not, this fits the bill. It's always a good idea, even though once you find this, to keep continue knocking others out, because under the best answer rule, you might find something weird down the line, which can raise a red flag. So D, complexities caused by difficulty in adjusting accounting inventory records. Well, that is right on point too. Difficulty in adjusting inventory and accounting records. So D is all right. E, complexities caused by multiple commodities or applicable general manufacturing drawback ruling or specific manufacturing drawback ruling. So the drawback ruling, general specific manufacturing, is on the list, so this one is okay. So since we're looking for one that's not, this is clearly the line item which is missing from those six reasons to say no. So C is our choice. All right, so how much drawback can you get back? Well, you can get 99% or less of duties, which includes estimated, final, and voluntary tenders, which includes money which you anticipate other right amounts for the liquidation. Marking duties, so marking duty would be 10% if you didn't mark your product appropriately. IRS taxes, which are considered as duties. MPF, under the Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act, it became applicable across the board. I'm still not sure about harmonized maintenance fee, harbor maintenance fee, I'm sorry, because harbor maintenance fee is applicable to the harbors, to improve the harbor. Customs may interpret it as it is not applicable to merchandise. The drawback refunds is applicable on imported merchandise fees for all drawbacks. So customs may not interpret merchandise fee as applicable to the harbor maintenance fee if the import is made by vessel, by the ship. But again, I'm not going to say never, so time will show how the interpretative methodology will be. For now, I'm not putting it out there. And liquidated damages, so something, if you haven't done your obligations under the bond, customs, you agree that customs will assess the liquidated damages in particular amount, and this particular and what amount is discussed under the relevant bond chapter.